Hey, welcome to episode 4 of the Hansy Comprehensive Exam Podcast. I am one of your hosts, Lindsay Odin. Today on the show, we have my friend Stephen Bohigian, a historian of race in the American West. Our topic of discussion is historical inaccuracies in movies, particularly representations of race, as well as hidden ideologies of nationalism. This was a megapod. It's really long, but we had such a great discussion, and I hope you find strength within yourself to listen to the whole thing. On to the show. This episode is brought to you by rulers. Rulers allow you to measure short distances across two-dimensional objects like paper and desks. But rulers also allow you to measure more intangible aspects of complex identities like, that guy is straight as a ruler. Trust rulers from the makers of other heteronormative office supplies like pencil sharpeners and staplers. Rulers, the straight man's straight edge. All right, let's go ahead and get started. I am your host, Lindsay Odin, joined by...
This is Hannah here, your other host.
Thank you. And we're talking with Stephen Bohigian today. Go ahead and say hello.
Honorary host.
Honorary.
Stuart Bohemian.
Stuart Bohemian.
Yeah. Okay.
We need to check my birth certificate again.
I would love to see your birth certificate. Actually, it was the only way that I would allow
I
you into the house.
I actually really want
to
see your driver's license again.
That, and I also think they spelled my last name wrong on my birth certificate, but we need to check into that.
Well, that would be a real tragedy of all kinds of Armenian genocide type tragedy.
Getting heavy already. First 30 seconds. Wow, going with the Armenian genocide joke.
Okay, well, I don't know why we're still messing around, so let's just get into it.
You didn't think that the whole show would be like this?
Stephen, what is it that you do?
Well, I do lots of things, but I think the number one thing I do is I'm a PhD student at UNLV in the history department, with you fine people, and I study the American West in the 20th century and race relations within the American West in the 20th century.
What would you say is your very narrowest specialty?
Well, my master's thesis was on housing segregation in the African-American community in West Fresno, in my hometown of Fresno, California. Nowadays, I'm trying to look at black nationalism within LA and its relationship and the relationship to the LAPD more broadly.
Excellent.
Yeah.
What drew you to this field?
Actually, it was my grandpa. My grandpa telling me stories. Both my grandparents, I was very close with. They're both in World War II. Both served, one as a bomber pilot and another in the Philippines, and just hearing stories from them about their experiences at a very young age during like middle school really got me interested in history. So I started, as most historians, as interested in World War II and all things History Channel. And then it kind of mushroomed from there. So I would say that that's how it happened.
That's how it happened.
All my grandparents, yeah.
Did you ever build model airplanes? Like, were you?
I did, but I didn't do the ones with glue because they were too hard. I was right. All snap models. I was too frustrated. I was
no,
too frustrated
no
of a kid to take time to do glue. That wasn't my thing.
All right. Well, we know you're a historian of race. Who would you say are your biggest influences?
I would say most recent influences, it only took me like 40 years to get to him, but Edward Said and a lot of his ideas of like the racial other and the idea of Orientalism is really resonated with me over the last semester. Within my previous focus of California, I would say that the historiography surrounding Southerners moving to California and kind of changing the cultural, religious, political landscape of the state is very, very influential to me.
Well, I want to talk about Said.
Yes.
Obviously, he's one of my favorites. So you just recently, what have you been reading by Said?
I bought Orientalism, but I also bought his Reader, which has a bunch of collected writings of his. And I was dipping into, obviously, the introduction of Orientalism, but also the... His essays on like Palestine and Israel, I think, are really compelling, especially him being from the area and being Arab and his experiences. Those have been really influential. And off the top of my head, I can't remember. This was over October when I was looking at him. But yeah, a lot of those writings have just been kind of life altering, at least intellectually.
Right. And he's not a historian by training.
No.
He's a literary critic. He's a literature professor, or was when he was alive. Yeah. He was a professor of literature. And so do you find any of those parts of his oeuvre particularly problematic for you as a historian?
No, I would say actually the opposite. I myself have been more interested in literary criticism and looking at different things like novels as sources and things to be kind of deconstructed and analyzed as a historian. So his treatment of like Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness was really compelling to me because, you know, he's taking something that a lot of us don't, as historians, we don't look at as a source. And he kind of pulls it apart and says, look, this is a way that the West and the Occident creates this kind of like Oriental, this idea of Orientalism, you know, this racial other that's so much different and savage and just far removed from our own existence. So no, I would say the opposite. Yeah, I think I really like that he does that. It can have its problems, but sure. I like that he does that though.
Well, do you ever find that he totalizes the West in the same way that he claims the West totalizes the
East? That was the whole critique of Orientalism and why he had to respond to it. It was because, you know, the racial other is exactly that. It's a binary. It's the racial other and then everyone else. And there's these kind of two groups when obviously it's not that homogenous. So
right. Yeah. And we read about Dominic LaCapra last week.
We did.
And his criticism of people like Hayden White for their easy categorizing, you know, because the categories were too easy and too simple and too rigid in a lot of ways. So I think that when we approach Said now, we approach it within a much broader framework because we bring that as historians, that we attempt to problematize his criticism, which I think is probably correct, but to bring it within that larger context, right?
Well, I think this is the discussion we're talking about in class today. The book we'd read was Colonialism in Question by Frederick Cooper, and a lot of it was him as a scholar of colonialism and empire saying that our terminology, words we use, the ones he pointed out were identity, modernity, and globalization. He goes, these terms are like scholars have used them to, for lack of a better word, like willy-nilly, and we need to kind of like redefine these terms and kind of reel it in from just being catch-all phrases that we throw out in our work. So I think, you know, is Said perfect as a scholar? No, but I think a lot of his ideas with a lot of these people, we just need to kind of redefine and make them more specific to our own work, you know, if we're going to use them. It doesn't mean that it's like, just because it worked for him in the 70s for the treatment he was using doesn't mean it works for us. We need to kind of mold these a little bit.
Well, and that's why I think Foucault is still relevant, because I don't think there are many historians who would say they do history like Foucault did history.
No, yeah.
Right. And so when I think about Foucault or I think about power, it's less about the conclusions that he made, his arguments, which have been picked apart endlessly on empirical grounds. I look at them more as theoretical arguments, ways of structuring my understanding, right? Yeah. So how then does Said apply to your work with race in the United States?
Well, I think the way I've been thinking about this a lot lately about my own up, you know, you're always kind of thinking in the back of your head like, oh, I got this dissertation thing I've got to write one day. And so I've been trying to like formulate the ideas. But I think in a lot of ways that I would really like to, like we were talking about earlier about sources, and I would like to make almost like verging on American studies as being more inclusive with my sources, in that, you know, a novel or a song or like these different types of things can be treated as historical sources if we interrogate them the way we do other sources. So I would say that's like the literary criticism part of Said's work, I think, is a way that I would like to kind of like, I would like to move my research in that direction and not just basing it on these like, you know, everything is archives and everything is like so empirical. Not that archives are always empirical, but I'm saying not so based in empiricism, like really broadening it out more.
Right, because the LAPD probably has excellent organizational archives.
Excellent. Yeah, and they publish a pamphlet every single, not only a pamphlet, like a booklet of all their stats every single year. So it's very easily accessible.
All for like the whole 20th century?
Yeah, like it's actually kind of nuts. It's really lucky. So if you want to study the city's relationship or the, you know, Chinese population's relationship or whatever with LAPD, mm-hmm. you have a good starting point. Obviously, you need other sources or you're just writing institutional history.
Right.
But it's a really good starting point. And yeah, they publish it every year, apparently. And so, yeah, that's there. That's out there floating around.
Do you have a working thesis for your dissertation?
I don't. The way I describe what I'm doing right now is that all these ideas are kind of floating above my head, and I kind of need to grab them out of the air and put them together into a more cohesive thought. I'm really interested in applying some kind of like post-colonial theory to what I'm doing, but it's problematic in numerous ways,
right.
But I'm actually really, I don't want to say shoehorn, but I want to try to see if this is applicable to what I'm talking about, even though post-colonialism is very much a theory based in Europe, and in Africa and other such places. So, long story short, no, I do not have a working thesis.
I would love to see how you could possibly spin the West as an extension of the American Empire,
yeah.
Because there are, as we know, there are several waves of immigration that come from the East of mm-hmm. Europeans, yeah. and then of course African Americans,
Mexican Americans,
yeah. And at the same time, of course, there were people who were already there,
yeah.
And land dispossession by the Spanish, and then later by the Americans or by whomever.
Yeah.
And so I would love to see how you could interpret that space, because you're working in the 20th century.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not that I want to stay segmented off from like, oh no, the 19th century is not a place. No, not at all. Like
right.
With my thesis I wrote, I started in the 19th century because it was necessary to start in the 19th century. You don't get the 20th century segregation of African Americans without talking about the 19th century segregation of
yeah.
like the Chinese and Japanese. So I think the idea that I would kind of compartmentalize history like that is like incredibly dangerous,
of course,
and irresponsible. So I consider myself a 20th century historian, but I love working in the 19th century as well. But also one thing I like to say also about this is that all of my idea comes from Huey Newton and the Black Panthers and their idea that how they rejected the legitimacy of the U.S. government, and they saw African Americans in the U.S. as a colony and the U.S. as greater empire. So I think that's where all these kind of ideas that I've been coming up with like stem from, is this idea
sure.
that Black nationalist groups, well, especially Black Panthers, I don't want to you know, throw a blanket over everything, but Black nationalist groups like Black Panthers much of the time rejected the legitimacy of the U.S. government and saw them as greater empire and black residents as a colony.
Right. And you know, work that I did recently was on hip-hop music,
yeah,
hardcore
yeah.
rap, and so I got to use a lot of those sources, and my argument was that there are legitimate political discourses that come from gangster rap and hardcore rap.
Definitely.
That comes from the Black nationalist movement,
mm-hmm.
and I think your project is fascinating and much in line with mine, but mine, of course, is down at the end of the 20th century, beginning of the
yeah.
21st century, and are you thinking then of periodizing your work more closer to the turn of the century, or how do you perceive it?
No, I think a lot of it will take place in the 60s and in the like early 70s, and really when like Black nationalism is really gaining a foothold. But I'm really interested in seeing the long development of the Black population in Los Angeles's like relationship with the LAPD, and this has been done here and there by different articles and everything. But I the last thing I want to do, though, at the same time is tell this, you know, from 1882 to 2015
right.
is the history. You know, that's the last thing I really want to do. But yeah, I see myself working very much in like the civil rights era, because that's what got me into doing history of like race and African-American history more specifically.
Nice.
Yeah.
What kind of I don't know if you've really like gotten into research yet, but what kind of like alternative sources do you think are out there for that subject matter?
I think I'm going to put a lot of weight into a lot of these, and I haven't gotten out there and
right.
really started like digging through all this stuff, but a lot of these pamphlets that these Black nationalist groups were, and more specifically like Black Panthers were creating, they've been treated in numerous ways in lots of different books and articles and everything, but I really want to treat them as legitimate, like, political and revolutionary discourse that is, you know, it's legitimate. It's not some, you know, look at these people, these radicals. I don't want to treat it like that at all. I want to look at it as like, this is a very, I think, legitimate claim that people like the Black Panthers were making. It's like, you can understand why they would do the things they would do. And you can understand what would push them to go in that direction.
Well, and you know, a lot of them are still alive.
Very much still.
You can collect endless oral histories.
Yeah, Black Against Empire, which was released, I think, 2 years ago, which is a political history of the Black Panther Party by Waldo Martin. It was, they did oral interviews with many of the surviving Black Panthers members, which is pretty amazing.
What about in terms of art? I'm thinking specifically poetry.
Yeah, definitely.
Music.
There's a book by David Widener called Black Arts West, I believe, and he focuses on the cultural Black cultural side of Los Angeles and all the things like art and poetry that's going on. I need to that will be, I think, much more than I originally thought. I think that will be a really good work for me to look at, because I saw it during my when I was writing my thesis, but it wasn't as necessary for me then.
I think somebody that I mined heavily for my paper was Trisha Rose and her mm-hmm. work on Black music, mm-hmm. which I think would be a rich source for you.
Yeah,
and definitely. Lipsitz, obviously, mm-hmm. it seems pretty obvious, especially his work on youth culture.
Yeah,
and things like that.
Well,
so
I think I was gonna say, I think also it's great, Lindsay, about what you were saying is that you said in your paper you treated gangster rap music in the 90s as legitimate, like you said, this is a legitimate political discourse, right?
Well, it's because I was contrasting it to the media narratives that had been spun about it.
I think,
to say that gangster rap is an illegitimate form of discourse because of its calls for violence and misogyny.
Yeah.
And I said, well, yes, it's unquestionably violent and misogynistic, but also there's all these other things.
Contextual issues.
Yeah. I mean, the fact was that the predominantly white newspaper writers had ignored many other parts of their themes or their lyrics or mm-hmm. whatever that they were doing. They were ignoring the larger project, which was to say, to try and accurately represent what their lived experience had been with police brutality, the war on drugs, poverty.
Especially then, yeah.
Yeah, and so when they are demonized for their violent imagery, their violent imagery is usually pointed at people who are oppressing them.
Exactly. Yeah, and I think that's a really great argument to make, is because this doesn't come out of a vacuum. You know, you don't get gangster music out of a vacuum. It's like, no, you get it from the Reagan 80s, and you get it from arrest rates in Los Angeles of all Black youths being pretty much what was it? I think it was half of all Black Los Angelinos were classified as gang members during that time from the new police initiative they'd imposed. So you wonder why people react this way.
The stereotype is the young, angry black men.
Yeah, exactly.
What the fuck do you think they were angry at?
Yeah, exactly. This is completely a created problem that is not of their making, I would say. This stretches back much further, obviously.
All right, let's move on then. Instead of what we usually do is we do a section called Contemporary Topics and Takes, where we talk about something that's in the news. And I thought we could stray from that a little bit, considering the controversy that is currently in the media about American Sniper.
Yes.
And American Sniper, directed by Clint Eastwood, it portrays the life and struggles of a sniper who fought in the Iraq War, and you know it takes pretty heavily from Kyle's book. That's his name.
Yeah.
And the problem with the book is that it's been shown in many instances to contain either large exaggerations
or
complete fabrications.
Yeah.
And Clint Eastwood's treatment of the book is completely uncritical.
Yeah. Which is not surprising.
No, of course not. It's not surprising at all. But because of the controversy surrounding the movie, I wanted to talk to you, and of course to Hannah, about historical movies and historical inaccuracies in movies. And so you came prepared with some notes, and I want to engage you on your notes.
Well, I think since you brought up the American Sniper movie, which I think is a great starting point, the star of Selma came out, and he made the controversial, which we don't know why it's controversial, but he made the statement that, and I quote, "We as Black people have been celebrated more for when we are subservient, when we are not being leaders or kings or being at the center of our own narrative." And I would kind of like to go off from there to discuss not only the glaring omissions from the Oscar nominations this year, which were just incredible. It's almost seemed this year like Hollywood said, hey, look, we did 12 Years a Slave thing last year. Black people have had their place in the sun, so let's give it back to the white soldier and like nominate Hurt Locker again for Why Don't We, you know? And, let's do that again. And so
they just to interject, his name is David Oyelowo.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so the idea that, it got a Best Picture nom, but the idea that they would not nominate him for Best Actor is kind of odd because he drives the entire movie. It seems so. And I think there's a really good quote here, and it revolves around The Patriot from the year 2000, 15 years ago, The Patriot came out. And we can spend all day talking about The Patriot and how The Patriot is so inaccurate. But at the end of the day, it is, as Ebert pointed out, it's a blockbuster. And there's only so much wiggle room they give to these summer blockbusters. But I would I want to quote him also from his review of The Patriot. And he says, Hollywood movies are at pains these days to provide a role for heroic African-Americans Now we have a black slave who fights beside white men, even those who hate him, because General Washington has promised freedom for all slaves who'd fight for a year. Good enough, but why not go all the way and give this character dialogue and a real role to play? And I think this bounces completely off the point of, what is it, Oyelowo, and his discussion of how blacks in film, when they are celebrated for their acting, it is usually completely in a subservient role, whether it's well acted or not, and the glaring issue with that. Do you guys, like, for example, we have The Help, also The Help.
Exactly. And that was its number one criticism, was the movie is called The Help. Yep. First of all, the most condescending name you could possibly come up with.
Yeah.
I think ironically, but
yeah.
Not ironic in a helpful way.
No.
But also, the center character of the movie, of course, is a white woman.
Yes.
And it's not about the help.
Yeah, and it's sad because there's been a... It's really funny. I looked up... since 2000, there have been four Hollywood movies focusing on slavery, and three of them were from 2012. So from 2012, we have 12 Years a Slave, we have Django Unchained, and we have Lincoln, three completely different portrayals of slavery in all its forms. And then the fourth movie is this American-British film, which I actually don't know if it even came from Hollywood, but I do remember seeing trailers for it, called Amazing Grace. But
Amazing Grace with Ian Gruffudd.
Yes, I believe so.
Yeah, starring a white guy.
Yes, exactly. So
he's an abolitionist politician. Yes. In Parliament. That's what the story is about.
So I think it's worth having the conversation, especially since we had three movies that came out in 2012. And 12 Years a Slave, I would argue is probably the best movie that's ever been made on slavery. And I don't think there's much competition, which is my point. But also Django Unchained, which I know how you feel about that, Lindsay, and Lincoln, which I think this is a good point because I don't think Lincoln has been torn apart enough as a movie about slavery and about white men and what they did to help slavery end. I'll start with Hannah, because she's always so quiet.
I'm ready.
Did you see all three of these movies?
No.
You didn't. Which one did you see?
I haven't seen Lincoln, but I've seen the other two.
You haven't seen Lincoln. Okay, so what were your thoughts? Since I can imagine your thoughts for 12 Years a Slave. So.
Oh no, I haven't seen 12 Years a Slave.
Okay, so
I've just seen
Django.
Django Unchained. Yeah.
You did see that.
Yeah.
Okay. What was your? Did you see it in theaters?
I don't think so.
What was your gut reaction to Django Unchained? Just
first? Oh, it was hard to watch. Definitely.
Yeah. Why
hard
was it
to watch?
Why though?
Just the violence of man on man, even just like humanity's violence to another human being.
Yeah.
I guess that was difficult to watch.
Was there a certain scene that you remember distinctly that was like hard to watch?
The dog scene.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I think it's seen it. For those who haven't seen it, there is a scene where a slave who is a Mandingo fighter, which is basically when two slaves are tasked with basically killing each other for the sport of the slave owner, he is trying to escape and they catch him. And while everybody watches on, Leonardo DiCaprio kind of toys with him intellectually and then sicks a dog on him. And yep. you kind of, you know, Quentin Tarantino is known for his violence in movies, but actually he was pretty sparing with how he did that scene. He could have made it a lot worse, all things considered. It was a really awful scene regardless, though. But yeah, there's that. And then there's also the actual scene of the Mandingos fighting and just all the awful implications of like the things you see and don't see. And you see someone's eyes get gouged out and everything. I don't know, Lindsay, what was your, cause I know you weren't a fan of Django Unchained, right?
I'm not a fan of Tarantino.
You're not a fan of Tarantino.
I think Tarantino is a goddamn hack.
No, I'm going to, let's not go into that cause I'll go on forever. Not
good
that
thing
I'm
you guys
not,
are 5 feet apart from each other.
Yeah. Good thing we're 5 feet apart. It should be 15. But what was your main issue with Django Unchained? Let's start there.
My main issue with Django, I guess it's the portrayal of the black character.
Yeah.
Which is to say, what is the motivation behind Jamie Foxx's character? And who are the other African-American actors who are revolving in the matrix of the movie?
Okay, so let's start with the, yeah. for people who haven't seen it, let's start with the motivation. What is the motivation of Jamie Foxx's character?
He's trying to rescue the love of his life.
Yes, who's also a slave in Mississippi.
Right. Yeah. And at the beginning of the movie, I forget how he gets free.
He's free rescued. From Christoph Waltz.
Yeah, he's rescued by a white guy. Yeah. So let's put a tack in that for a second. That his resistance is neutered by being rescued by a white person. He goes on to be tutored by Christoph Waltz's character in the ways of killing so that he can exact the revenge he wants against is it his wife or his girlfriend?
It's his wife.
Yeah, against his wife's captors. And then he does. And my impression from the beginning is that this is not a story of black resistance.
Wait. Sorry to stop you. Who kills Leonardo DiCaprio's character, who is the head plantation owner?
Spoiler alert.
Yes, spoiler alert. Turn your radio or whatever, your transistor radio. Turn it off now. Turn it off.
Take out your cassettes.
Yes, turn the cassette off. Stop the vinyl. Spoiler alert.
Yeah, if you haven't seen this movie in the last few years. So the main villain of the movie is killed by Christoph Waltz.
Exactly.
The white guy. And I think that it's, from the very beginning, it's a story of co-option. That Django becomes a slave to his revenge. He becomes a slave to his tutor in a lot of ways. Even though Christoph Waltz's character, what's his name? I don't remember.
It is Dr. King Schultz.
That's right. So,
which is, it references something in history, but we just don't know what. Dr. King, it sounds really familiar. Yeah. But anyway, keep going.
Well, he becomes a slave to the doctor, not through bondage, but through obligation. Yeah. And my problem from the beginning is how Tarantino treats black characters in all of his movies. And this is an example where a black character is supposed to be the protagonist, and yet time after time after time is undermined at every corner by a white character.
Until the end where he actually starts, well, he kills a lot of people in the movie, but at the end where they come back and especially, well, we'll get into this in a little bit, but especially, what's his name? Samuel L. Jackson's Uncle Tom character. But I think the problem that you're pointing out here too, and there's another underlying issue with this movie, is that I saw the movie twice in theaters, and I saw it in two very different theaters. I saw it in the theater at the side of town near where my parents live, and there were actually some African-American, you know, couples and actually people in the theater, and it was a really good experience, you know, just a good experience. I'll leave it at that. And then I saw it at the very white northern part of town at what's called River Park, our shopping area, and this is where all like the little teenies go to like go to SBI, which is a skate shop. Sorry, I realized that's not a chain that goes over. But anyway, this is where they go, and there's like, you know, there's like all this, there's food there, there's shopping, whatever. Anyway, and it was full of little white kids snickering every time the N-word was used.
Of course.
And I guess my main issue with it is that one of my issues with Lincoln was the fact that they never used the N-word in the movie because it would make the white characters seem that much worse, which is completely ahistorical. Instead of Steven Spielberg being like, look, this is how they spoke back then, and this is how these legislators and these like elected officials talked about black people, it's completely watered down so it doesn't offend any of the people going, wow, that we were kind of racist back then.
And it's just more hero worship of Lincoln. Now, we can admit a lot of things about Lincoln. Who gave the Emancipation Proclamation?
Yeah.
Lincoln. Okay, we get it. What we forget is that at best, at very best, Abraham Lincoln is a paternalistic racist.
Yeah.
At worst, he thought blacks would never be the intellectual equals of whites.
And and before we even go into this further, like my last point about Django Unchained is that, you know, the context in which there's two ways, I think, if you're going to use the N-word within these historical dramas or whatever you want to call them, it needs to be used. But the way Tarantino uses it is not the right way to use it. He makes it become, it's farcical. It becomes a line to laugh at. You hear Samuel Jackson's character says the N-word, but he, you know, Hercules, and he calls it with the N-word first. And it's just like, it becomes a joke. And I think there needs to be a division there where it's like, look, this is a word that Southern plantation owners and Northern industrialists used as well. But do we need to be putting it in as like little, like, you know, quips and everything? And it's like, oh, look, the kids are laughing at the black man, the black Uncle Tom character saying the N-word. I think there's something fundamentally wrong with that.
Well, maybe Tarantino was trying to use it so much because he wanted to kind of give the audience today the feeling that it was like just a casual thing, like it happened all the time.
Well, the problem though with that, and that could be it, but Tarantino has used the N-word a lot in his films. Like, that's, he's actually gotten criticized a lot for it before.
And he uses it when he's a character in his films, like Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction, yeah, which is the most obvious example. Does this, you know, look like dead N-word storage when they talk about the black guy?
Sorry, Quentin, you can't get away with that anymore.
Yeah. And so I think the issue is, and that could be it. I mean, and I don't think that the amount of times they use the N-word in that movie is egregious within the context. I think the problem with it is that he makes it, a lot of the lines, he tries to make the word funny. Mm. And I think that's the problem with a lot of like youth culture today, is that the N-word has become this thing where it's like anybody can say it, and anybody can say it in any context because they heard on rap music, for example.
Well, as long as you say it with an A at the end, it's okay.
Exactly, yeah. It's not an ER. It's not a hard N. Yeah.
My problem is that when Tarantino uses it, even if he's trying to deconstruct it using humor, I don't think it's successful.
No, I don't think so.
The way that it is successful is to portray in all of its darkness.
Yeah.
You know, to make sure that it has the full force, that when people use it on screen, they're doing it for a purpose.
Exactly.
So that when we, in the 21st century, look back, we can say, oh, look, how archaic.
Yeah. And I think, you know, getting back to Lincoln now, is that Lincoln, the problem with Lincoln is that it's made by a really good director, Steven Spielberg.
Yeah, we're going to talk about Spielberg again.
Yeah, but Steven Spielberg, I mean, regardless of everybody can say like, oh no, I like independent films and blah, 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 blah. You know, I love independent films too, and I love, you know, non-Hollywood pictures, but I think you have to respect Spielberg for what he does well, and it's a really well-constructed movie. It's a well-shot movie. It's got a compelling narrative, but the fundamental flaw here is that people walk out of that going, oh, look, the black people kind of sat up in the rafters with Mary Todd and waited for emancipation to get passed down to them.
Thank you.
Which is completely untrue. And numerous historians of abolition and race have come out and really torn apart that movie because of its portrayal.
That movie forgets that there was centuries of slave resistance.
Yeah, exactly.
That they weren't sitting there waiting for the paternalistic whites to emancipate them. That is a myth and is propagated by movies like Lincoln, which portray them as sitting in the back of the proverbial bus.
And it's really, it's incredibly unfortunate too, because you almost expect more out of Spielberg for what he's trying to do. But then you remember, it's like, there's bigger forces at play here, I guess. And you know, no one, they want to watch Daniel Day-Lewis, which I love Daniel Day-Lewis. Don't get me wrong. I could watch the guy eat yogurt. You know what I mean? It'll probably be entertaining. He'll probably eat yogurt better than anybody.
He'll drink your yogurt.
Yeah. He'll drink your yogurt.
Better than Jamie Lee Curtis.
But it's like, you know, but I don't know. We have to remember there's larger forces at play, but does that excuse it? No, not at all. It could have been a different movie. But I guess also he's going off the source material. Steeler's going off. He's going off Team of Rivals, which I didn't read because I
nobody reads
other
Doris
history.
Kearns Goodwin. Any serious academic who wastes their time on Doris Kearns Goodwin is doing a disservice to themselves and the people that they're colleagues with.
I'm sorry if we come off as snobby, but it's just, there's so many better books to read.
Guess what? The problem with popular novels. Sorry, that was a Freudian slip. I called it a popular novel.
It's not even a novel, but no. it was a Freudian slip, though.
The problem with historical books that are written for a popular audience is they must get to the common denominator.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, in this country, the common denominator is the power of whites.
Yeah.
And to say, look at all the things that these clever whites did.
Yeah, and it was... And I think you see that in the larger like narrative of Lincoln, and it's unfortunate because the like I said, the movie is not it's not a bad movie on its own. It's not a bad movie. It's a well made movie. And it's a compelling movie, but you know when I saw it, I saw it with my dad and my two friends, and I walked out of there and it was like, oh wow, that was a great movie, Daniel Day-Lewis, my God. And I kind of step back and be like, well, what's wait what? No, this is not aligning with my the other books I've read about this and about abolition. It's unfortunate. It also makes it look like it also I think is a really important point to stress is that it makes it look like slavery ended with that.
Oh,
and
God, yeah.
It's like, yes, the institution of slavery was dead as an institution in the South, but then we had sharecropping, and then we had chain gangs, and then we had Jim Crow, and then we had debt peonage. Exactly. We had all these things that came after in the wake of slavery that may not have been, I'm not even saying may not have been, were incredibly brutal. Were incredibly brutal and kept an entire race of people even further subjugated after emancipation. And so
that doesn't even count the experiences that are still happening in the 21st century.
Exactly.
Where there are very compelling arguments for how slavery continues to exist in this country for racial minorities.
Yeah.
Despite the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments.
Exactly. Exactly. And so I think like I said, the main issue with Lincoln is that this makes it look like it ended there. And it was, you know, like, you know, and Reconstruction fixed everything. It's like Reconstruction failed, and it failed because of white politicians selling out and not, well, obviously Andrew Johnson too, selling out any kind of, you know, he could have backed up all black representation in Congress, but he didn't. But this is the problem with movies like Lincoln. But then turning 12 Years a Slave, and the comments came out at the same time, but Steve McQueen, not that Steve McQueen, the director Steve McQueen, who is he's from, he lives in the Netherlands now, but he's British, and it took a black British guy to make the most honest movie about slavery, about American slavery, I think is really compelling, and an almost entirely international cast. Michael Fassbender is German, I believe. And Chatwell, what's the main guy?
Geofor?
Yeah, he's British. Also British. Yeah, he's British as well. I remember seeing him in Love Actually, which is a weird, you know, look back. I'm like, oh yeah, this is the guy from 12 Years a Slave.
With Rick Grimes.
Yeah, come to steal your girl.
It was
Rick
Tatership. It was really odd the fact that it took that kind of cast and that kind of director, which I don't think Steve.
Well, maybe it's not so odd. Maybe
yeah,
it needed
exactly.
an outside voice, somebody who wasn't deep mm-hmm. into American culture to kind of come in and make that kind of a movie.
I think that's a really good point. I think you're completely right, actually, is it takes, it's sad that it took that.
Yeah.
But I think it did take that, and it, you know, it takes this international cast to really be like, look, slavery was not some fucking joke. You know what I mean? This isn't a bunch of like, you know, working in the fields, you go home and you sleep. You know what I mean? Like you can go to South Carolina right now and take a tour of a plantation and they'll tell you that's how it was and it wasn't that bad. But I really think as difficult as 12 Years a Slave is to watch, it really illuminates some of the, not only the awful parts of slavery, which we know about, but really like how deep seated these things are and how terrible the system was or the institution was more generally throughout the South. It really does in a very, very good way. In a very good way for the viewer, at least, to understand the gravity of it all.
I think that's a good place. Let's transition from you.
Yes.
Come over to Hannah. You want to talk about
sure.
what research you did on this topic?
I didn't do a lot of research, but I guess something that I am always questioning myself about is, can I just enjoy a movie for its like pure entertainment value? Or should I be thinking about things more deeply? So I chose one of my favorite films to kind of think about a little bit more, and that's The Last of the Mohicans, which was made in 1992.
Daniel Day-Lewis again.
Last of the Bohigians, which is a joke I've been waiting to bust out there. So it's out there now. It's out there. Public domain. Yes, Daniel Day-Lewis. Another Daniel Day-Lewis.
Yeah, directed by Michael Mann. It was...
Really?
Incredibly popular.
Oh, wow.
It had a lot of commercial success. So it's based, I think it's a kind of an interesting one to discuss since it was based on a novel by James Fenimore Cooper. So set in Seven Years' War, if you haven't seen it, which is 1757. It's basically about, it's kind of like a, should I describe it or should we just assume
give
that?
Give us a brief
Give
synopsis.
Us a little brief synopsis.
Okay,
why is it called The Last of the Mohicans?
Yeah, why? Why?
Well, it's there are still Mohicans in the world, so it's not true.
Exactly. Yes.
The main character is Daniel Day-Lewis. He plays Hawkeye. He's been kind of adopted by a family who are Mohican and a father and son. And they help these two British girls get from one place to another. And while that's happening, there's a war going on, battles, and then bad Indians at the same yes. time. That's quoted. You can't
yes,
see me.
You can't see our fingers, but we're doing
yeah,
quotes. Bad
that.
Indians, quote unquote.
But, so that's a little.
Well,
a little
so Daniel Day-Lewis, because I've never seen it. So he's adopted.
No, you haven't. Yeah, right?
Yeah, he's definitely white in the movie.
Yeah, he's definitely,
is,
I know he's
this
definitely
is not, this is not
white.
A Lone Ranger thing where they're like putting a dead crow on his head and being like, look, Johnny Depp's, he's Native American now. Like, no.
Yeah.
He's
no, in this movie, so like the main, I looked it up. I was interested. The main characters who play the main Native American characters, Wes Studi, he's an actual Cherokee Indian. Eric Schweig, I'm not sure how you pronounce that. He's Inuit. And then Russell Means is Oglala Lakota.
Oh, wow.
So none of them are Mohican or even from a northeastern
I'm
tribe.
I'm surprised they even got Native Americans, actually.
Yeah.
I'm wow, good job, guys. You actually
so the
got
pros.
Native Americans.
I got a list of pros from this movie. So that was that was pretty cool. I mean, they tried to cast
yeah, at least Native Americans. I mean,
Native American
it'd be like,
actors.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'll give Hollywood credit for that.
They get 1 point. They're up and positive.
Yeah.
So another good thing, they tried to like get experts. They had a Delaware language experts on the movie. So they tried to like get the like lingo right. And then they're also pretty accurate with their portrayal of like, props and clothing. So material culture is pretty accurate.
Surprise. There was no feathers and headdresses.
Well,
I actually don't
really.
Think there were. No,
sorry. I have not seen it. So I feel like I'm out
Lindsay,
of
Lindsay, we
you
gave you the movie
it.
2 weeks ago. You didn't watch it.
I just know this is what I know about The Last of the Mohicans. And you'll probably touch on this. The theatrical release poster is a picture of
Daniel Day-Lewis. Yes.
Oh
it
yeah,
is.
It's all about him, and the like really attractive part of the movie is his romance with Cora,
and he's
the daughter
himself.
Of the British like general or something. Yeah, so. And he has beautiful hair. it's
really
all about his
two
hair.
Two white people in love.
Yeah.
Circled by a cast of almost appropriately cast co-stars.
Almost.
Yeah, almost.
Almost.
Closer.
Yeah.
We're getting close.
Big underline under that almost.
What else did I want to say?
It's like calling your movie Selma and then having a bunch of white people.
Yeah.
In blackface.
Yeah.
Right. So, historical inaccuracies I don't think bother me as much as the like Native American tropes that are in the movie.
Yep.
So some of the inaccuracies historically... it's like the modernization of the actions of the characters and how they have British, like lower ranking British soldiers talking to upper ranking about individual rights, which really wasn't like
what?
Something
are you
that
serious?
Happened at
I don't remember
time.
That part. I haven't watched it for years.
Yeah.
That is ridiculous.
Very
that is the
interesting
most
American anachronism right there.
Yeah, it's the thing about the British Army is they don't care about your rights back in the 1750s. So yeah, there wasn't like a huge thing for them, you know?
And then also how they spin this romance of Hawkeye, who is definitely, he's like a hunter. He makes his living like on the land. And then Cora, who is kind of an upper class, she's the daughter of a general, and their romance would never happen in this type of a society. So that's
an
inaccuracy.
Ever. Well, I think also a good way to, look at this further is that the name itself is an egregious, affliction on Native Americans itself. There's a book by Jean O'Brien, but we called her Jeannie because that's
your
what Dr.
Buddies,
Bauer is.
Besties.
Dr. Bauer, hey, Dr. Bauer's friends with her, apparently, you know, so he called her Jeannie. So Jean O'Brien called Firsting and Lasting, and is about writing Native Americans out of Southern New England histories, basically. And the idea of lasting, which she comes up with, which is a pretty ingenious thing, is that talking about how these local histories written by whites talked about the last Indian in the area, or they sold their land to me and it was like the last one, you know? And this title is such an offender for that. It's like The Last of the Mohicans. Like, no, it was not the last. But this would have you understand, this is where historical contingency comes in. It's like the idea that Indians were always, or Native Americans were always disappearing, and they were always going to be gone, and they were always going to fall to white forces. And this just reaffirms that, is that they were on their way out. You know, we kind of, you know, settlers just kind of came in and listened to the death rattle, which is ridiculous, of course.
Right.
Yeah. So I think it's a really good point about that.
Okay, so the other huge trope that they fall into, which is a trope in a lot of film, television, and then also historical works, is like the dichotomy of the noble savage and then the savage Indian. So that, I think, is kind of characterized by two of the Native American characters in the movie. So the noble savage would be Chingachgook, who is the father. Mm-hmm. And especially the last scene of the movie where his son has just died, and then he's kind of like, he does this like prayer ritual, and it's just like a really, like, the ending, I think, is kind of bothers me the most.
I remember the ending being incredibly violent, obviously, but
right,
it really is not even just this noble savage, just savages, you know, look how bad these bad Indians are. They're so violent.
They, like, Magua would be the character. Yeah, like, exactly. The characteristic.
And there's no humanity to them, and they have like one, you know, one real motivation, that's to kill and to like chase, because they're like running. They remember they're escaping, right? And they're trying to like get away. Yeah, and they're being pursued.
Well, there's the Mohicans who are kind of like not involved in. There's only two of them left, you know.
Yeah, of course,
they're not really involved.
They're the last of them.
Not really involved in the battles, but the Huron tribe has kind of allied with the French troops. So while the Mohicans and Hawkeye and the ladies are like running around, the Huron are in there, and Magua would be the Huron character, so they're kind of attacking. And
do you remember if the movie says that it's the Seven Years' War or the French and Indian War? Do you remember?
Probably the French and Indian War,
I would imagine. And that's another, if it does indeed say that, and don't take my word for it, it's been a couple years, but I mean, that's another problem, is the idea that this is French and Indians, and that Indians didn't fight on the British side, and that they only fought on the French side, or they only fought
about all the Indians who didn't fight,
or the ones that didn't fight, there's so many issues with that, and I think that was something that we all got to touch on last year when we were teaching this section, is that, you know, this is not the French and Indian War, because this makes it sound like it's like you said, it's like a binary. Like
we didn't fight anybody.
Yeah, I didn't fight anybody.
The British and the American colonists.
I was in Armenia, or my family was in Armenia when all this was going down.
The British and the American colonists, along with some Native American bands, fought against the French and some other Native American bands,
exactly.
While there were a lot of people on all sides who did not fight.
And this is another problem with Hollywood and having to kind of shoehorn these really complicated narratives and complicated issues into an hour and a half or 2 hours or 2.5 hours and make it digestible and interesting for an audience. And it really, I think, gets to the root of what we're kind of dancing around here, is the idea of like the problem of historical inaccuracies in film. Because obviously films are not made for their historical inaccuracy unless they are specifically, like 12 Years a Slave, I would say, being made to tell the real story, not the, you know, not the the John Wayne story of Vietnam, a John Wayne story of World War II, or whatever other wars Lots of wars. He was in lots of war movies.
We're coming to war with me.
Yeah, I know we are. And I'm probably going to end up getting intense about this. But I think that's, I don't know, Hannah, if you want to go off of
that. Well, I think with The Last of the Mohicans, it's like not as cut and dry as with the movies that you mentioned, because it's based on a fictional novel. But then you have to think about how this movie is like perpetuating cultural stereotypes about Native American peoples. And I don't know.
Yeah.
It's really tough.
James Fenimore Cooper is not known for his well treatment of Native American actors in his books.
I guess this is really the issue, like you said, that we are dancing around with, is these kind of historical inaccuracies which are not problematized in their narratives.
No, not at all.
Right? Is that we see the films...
Very simple.
Well, they're supposed to be interpreted literally.
Yeah.
Isn't that... I mean, I could be...
Well, at least for these like summer blockbusters, like, you know, like I said, like The Patriot and Lincoln, like...
I think this was too.
Yeah, are no complications. Exactly. There are no complications with identity, binary, race, who the main characters are. Mm-hmm. Where are the women in all of these stories?
Oh, man. Cora. You guys can't see me right now, but I'm pulling a book up, and I'm like, where are the women?
I'm right here. I'm right here, you guys.
Yeah.
have you read the book?
I have not read the book.
So I haven't either, but I was kind of looking it up on the internet, and apparently Cora is the character in the book is half black and half white.
Oh, wow. So they didn't
And
do
they
that.
Took so they that, out that out of the movie. Movie.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, and God. I just... And in the book, she isn't... Her love interest isn't with Hawkeye, the white guy. It's with, Magua's in love with her. So it's like a really interesting, like,
this would have been a way more interesting movie.
Interracial kind of relationship. And they just kind of totally took that out and decided not to like deal with it at all.
Yeah.
Because the romance is way more fun to watch.
Yeah. Well, they gotta sell those tickets.
They braid each other's hair, probably.
Oh my God. Jesus. Well, the point that I'm getting at is that there are these books that never claim to be factual, right? They're always written as this is a novel. This, yes. These paratextual things. I talk about paratext a lot, but this is one of the points that I'm trying to make, is that the genre is really important to how they are interpreted by the audience. Because it's not even so much about the author's intent. Once it's in the theaters, the author has had their say for the most part. But when we say this is based on a book that is a novel, which is supposed to be fictional, mm-hmm. and then the events appear to be
real. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it is real.
It's rooted in history to say, oh, I guess this is how things were.
Yeah, that's how it played out.
Because the context is, for the most part, true, right? Mm-hmm. There were Mohicans at one time. There still are, right? And when we say they're the last of them, is to root it in this historical narrative, which gives it credibility. And it's a dangerous kind of credibility because we know that it's beyond that context, that the context does not shape the narrative to make it true. It doesn't make a fictional work factual.
And especially when we're talking about Native Americans too, and the last of them, it's just such a dangerous thing to say because it makes them, it's like they're not here today. And there are people of the past, and they're gone, and everything like
that. They're separate. They're
other. Yeah, exactly. And it's like, oh, that was a different time, and now we're in a more modern time, which is a very dangerous word. But I mean, this is a big issue. I was talking to Dr. Bauer, which is a Native American historian who works at UNLV, and I was saying that I wanted to use some post-colonial theory in this Native American term paper. This term paper based around settler colonialism and Native Americans in California, and he was saying, read this book. This is why you can't use post-colonial theory while you're talking to Native Americans. And the reason is because it's not post-colonial. They're still a colonized people.
Exactly.
Land taken away. Some of the most economically, the poorest, most impoverished people on the entire continent. And this is not post-colonial to them. They're still here, but they're still suffering the ramifications of like allotment and the reservation system. So I think getting back to the entire issue of like, the last of the Mohicans, like that in itself, just the name itself is such a dangerous thing for the American public to like, because they already have this in the back of their mind, and this just reinforces that.
Right.
Yeah. And it further romanticizes them as like fictional.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And the, like you said, the noble savage.
They're mythical.
Like, oh, they want to help. That's a nice Indian. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just really, I wish I had the balls to sit down and watch Lone Ranger so we can tear that apart, but fuck that. I am never sitting down watching that movie.
Hey, it's Lindsay here at Intermission. You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Screamin' Vegan. Follow Hannah on Instagram and Twitter at Hands_Labyrinth. Don't forget to like the Handsy Comprehensive Exam Facebook page at facebook.com/HandsyComprehensiveExam. Email the show, handsycompexam@gmail.com. Be on the lookout for new music tracks from my music project, Disciplinary Boundaries. Visit soundcloud.com/disciplinary-boundaries. And, of course, follow the Handsy Comprehensive Exam blog at handsycomprehensiveexam.com. Let's get back to the show.
It's my position on American Sniper, is that I certainly, I'm not going to give any of my money to it. I'm just not going to contribute. If you vote with your money, I'm not going to give any of my money to it. If I got to see it for free.
Yeah, I think that's how I'm going to go about it. Because what's really sad is that Clint Eastwood is a really great director, which is really odd because No, he makes some really great movies. Like Mystic River is a really like good, compelling movie. Gran Torino is, it's pretty melodramatic and ridiculous. But
you gotta think, who's the hero in Gran Torino?
For sure. Tons of issues with it. But I'm saying, as a director, he's not a hack, I'm guessing, is my point. He knows how to make a good movie.
Cinematography.
Yeah, cinematography, how he shoots his movies and everything. Sure. And he probably doesn't even do his own cinematography. But anyway, it's like, he's not a bad director considering how many dumb detective movies he did, like how many Dirty Harry movies were there, like five, I think. And when I saw the commercial for it, I'm watching in theaters and I'm like, is this really a movie about like white people shooting brown people in the desert again? Is this really what this movie's going to be? And then I saw like the reviews coming out and people were like, it's like the most money of like any movie, like over a certain amount of time. And like, so many Oscar noms. And I'm like, good Lord, I feel like the way you're going to win an Oscar is that you either make a Holocaust World War II movie or you make a movie about, like, Iraq, I guess. I guess that's a new thing, because Hurt Locker, I love that movie account. Catherine Bigelow, I was like, yeah. And I was like, fuck Avatar. Fuck that shit, man.
Well, it's so contemporary to our experience.
Exactly. And I was like, that's a great movie. And then I went back and rewatched Hurt Locker. That movie fucking shoves down its message like so much down your throat that you're just kind of like, my God, like why? Like, no, no. There's like no nuance to this. It's just like, war. It's a drug. Get it? Get it? We have a quote in the beginning that tells you that. In the end, you get it again. It's a drug. You know what I mean? And that was my movie trailer voice. But yeah, it's like these are the movies that are like singled out. And then once in a while, you have kind of this victory with 12 Years a Slave. And you get a movie that's like, God darn it, man. If it didn't win last year, I don't know what I would have done. But it's like, you know, finally a movie that deserves to win wins. And so I'm sure American Sniper will walk away with it this year. I'm sure it will. I don't see why it wouldn't. You know? Well,
let's transition then to my... If you're... happy
yeah
with.
I'm so done.
Okay. We'll transition to mine, and I picked a movie that did win Best Picture.
Yes.
Saving Private Ryan.
Yes.
Directed by Steven Spielberg. And this is going to make it seem like these film directors can't win, because I'm going to come back. We've been criticizing historical inaccuracy. I'm going to come back and say I criticize this movie because it's too accurate.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Here's okay. The twist. The movie was overwhelmingly described as one of the most accurate portrayal of war, yes, by people who experienced it, by people who were at Normandy.
Especially D-Day, yeah.
Right. Obviously. And they said over and over, this is the most realistic portrayal of war that we have seen in a movie. And my problem with that is the supposed accuracy is the problem, because it becomes a better form of simulation. That the simulation looks so accurate that the messages, the embedded ideology, is more insidious and harder to detect, because it's shrouded in both the paratextual element of people calling it accurate and then its actual portrayal, which strove to be accurate. Spielberg hired people who had experienced it to help him direct the film. He picked a cinematographer who portray the grittiness. And I mean, just the camera techniques that they use to show how real.
Can I highlight a little bit of this?
Please hit
it. Actually, I grew up like this. Is my favorite movie growing up. And a lot of the reasons you're actually talking about is that it was the most realistic. It was just, it's visceral, I think, is the best way to describe it. And Spielberg got Dale Dye, who is a longtime Hollywood military expert. He was in the military. If I knew the branch, I would tell you, but he has a cameo in all of his movies. He was like in Platoon. He was the guy who helped out Platoon. And all these movies, all these major military movies, he is the guy they go to for their historic realism of how these things happened. But Spielberg, what he does this, and a lot of film critics have pulled it apart and said, like, there's too many quick cuts in the movie. So there's kind of a disconnect between the characters. It's very much like jumping around everywhere instead of like, you know, actually following them up the beach. Another thing, though, is that he doesn't align, which I think is a really interesting thing that I think J.J. Abrams took to heart. And he does all his lens flare by...
he took
by
it so deep into it.
Tons, tons of lens flare by not lining up the cells or whatever he does. But it creates this really uncomfortable feeling when you're watching it. And he's also, what does he do? He desaturates all the colors as well.
Right.
And so, actually, there's a little funny story about when they showed it on TV. Yes, they showed this movie on TV. Like, I don't know how they did it. But anyway.
Yeah, they used to show it uncut.
Well, people, they showed it cut. And it's like, how do you do that? But it's like, people were calling in to, like, the station or whatever, or, like, whatever their provider's saying. Like, the colors were off. So they actually had to lighten it for TV because it was too dark for, like, viewers to grasp. But yeah, incredibly, what's interesting about Saving Private Ryan also is the attention to detail. Like you said, this gets back to your realism point. Is that if you watch Saving Private Ryan, not everything's happening at the front of the frame. A lot of stuff happens in the back. There's a scene when they're running through the trenches, and your eyes are up on the guys in the foreground running through the trench. But if you watch in the background, there's an extra way in the back. As he runs through a door, he gets a bullet in the head and falls down. And it's one of those things that a lot of directors wouldn't do. It's like, why would you waste money on a squib, you know, like an explosive blood capsulet? To be like, oh, look, like, you just wouldn't do it. But Spielberg,
how many takes would it take?
But Spielberg does this type of stuff to make the scene real, to make it feel alive. And I think that's something worth
to animate the background is to improve the context. So I bring it back. I say that it more insidiously masks the ideology that is within the simulation because it appears to be so accurate. And then you have to look also at the fictional elements, like we just talked about, the fictional elements that are embedded in real events. There was a Normandy invasion. there were Americans who fought and died, all of these things. But the rest of the film is a complete fabrication. I mean, the town that they go to doesn't exist.
Yeah, true.
I mean, all the characters, again, it's based on a novel. All the characters
based
are fictional.
On a real story of four brothers who died when, like, I think a ship went down.
Two of them survived.
But it's not like there's no, right. like, you know, there was no, like, journey to
I believe they were called the Nylands was their last name. Yeah. There were four of them. Three of them were presumed dead, so they pulled the fourth one out of combat. Turns out one of the other ones had survived, too. But yeah. It's based on somewhat of a true story. And I want to read this quote at length because I think it is exactly what I'm talking about. It comes from Janine Basinger in the October 1998 Perspectives on History. And the article is called Translating War, the Combat Film Genre, and Saving Private Ryan. And she talks about how the story format does not depart from the war genre overall. That the war genre, I'll just read you the quote.
Yeah,
I don't know why I keep talking. All right. The story format does not break with the established genre, except that the object of the group's mission is saving a single ordinary soldier for public relations concerns. It follows the traditional format of three basic elements: hero, group, and objective. The group is made up of a mixture of ethnic and geographic types, most commonly including an Italian, a Jew, a cynical complainer from Brooklyn, a sharpshooter from the mountains, a Midwesterner nicknamed by his state, Iowa or Dakota, and a character who must be initiated in some way, a newcomer without battle experience, and who will provide a commentary or explanation on the action as it occurs, a newspaperman, a letter writer, an author, or a professor. And in this case, it was the
Upham,
the translator.
Yeah, Upham.
Exactly.
I can give you all their names.
He literally translates the movie for the viewer.
He's the translator, and yeah, he translates.
Exactly. Back into the quote. Military iconography is used and explained. Conflict breaks out within the group itself, in which the objective is questioned, leadership is questioned, and the war itself is often questioned. Rituals from home are discussed and remembered, and new rituals from their comrade status are enacted. As the group advances, they encounter the enemy, and certain members die. A final climactic battle, often a last stand, referred to as an Alamo or Little Bighorn, mm-hmm. takes place, which reveals the film's overall purpose. The hero, who has usually had the objective forced on him, has to make a series of difficult and unpopular decisions. He sometimes survives, although most of his men don't, and he sometimes dies. The theme of Saving Private Ryan is to live a life worth living. So the author asks, have we as a nation earned the sacrifices that were made for our freedoms and way of life?
Yeah, and I believe the last line Tom Hanks says, he's the captain before he dies, is he goes, like, he says, earn this.
Exactly.
Yeah, he says, earn this.
And then old Private Ryan at the end of the film.
Yes. Have I been a good man?
Exactly.
Have I led a good life? Yes.
And so my question here then is, Saving Private Ryan is war porn. It is war pornography in that it seeks to force the question, have we earned it as a country? Have we earned what was fought for in World War II? Because World War II, almost unquestioningly, is the last justifiable war that the United States fought, right? We fought against fascism.
It's the last time we declared war.
We were attacked first.
Yeah.
Right? Those are the claims that are made about the war. And then that question is so poignant to say, have we earned it? Because of the implications. What have we earned? What is there to be earned? How have we earned it? How do we continue to earn it? It's by being good Americans. It's by living a life worth living, which is always implicitly constrained by the fact that we live in a culture that has prescriptions about how we should conduct ourselves in our daily lives. And so when the question is asked, have we earned it? The implications spin off infinitely into what do we have to do to earn it? Well, we have to be good Americans, right? And that's why I have a problem with Saving Private Ryan.
Okay, well, let's... Yes, I see many of your points, and I actually agree with many of your points. I'm glad you read that. Who is the person you read, and what are her credentials? And I don't mean that to undermine it, actually.
No. Janine Basinger, who is a film critic, I think at Wesleyan. I looked this up. I'll link it in the show notes. But awesome. She is an established professor of film studies.
Well, you know, that's actually that's something that I just, you know, completely flies over your head when you're 12 years old and you look back on these films. But it's totally true. This is it's a war genre film in that it has all the tropes and all of things. Like, because every character you mentioned,
it has the Italian,
is exactly
it has
there.
The sharpshooter, and he's
there's remember, the Jew.
No, remember the sniper in the film?
Yeah, he's the southern guy.
And he recites Bible verses.
He
as
has
he
Bible
shooting
verses.
His
he does.
I don't remember that.
Because he's southern.
Lay it on thicker.
Yeah.
Please lay it on thicker than your sharpshooter sitting in the bell tower, firing at Germans, yeah. reciting Bible verses.
Yeah, it's pretty intense. Yeah.
And then of course Private Ryan. Where is he from?
He is from, wait, don't say it. It's Missouri.
No, he's from Iowa.
No, he's not.
He is.
No, you're wrong.
No.
I think he's Missouri.
You're incorrect.
I got to look it up.
Did you know this is going to be a quiz about
Saving
Private Ryan?
I thought it was, yeah, because the whole thing about the film is that they're trying to figure out where he lives.
The point is that it fits all the tropes.
Is it Iowa? Really?
Yeah. Okay. He's from Iowa. It doesn't matter. I don't think it's important. But the idea is that you have to
It's important
to
Steven.
It's very important to me.
Think about the ethnic makeup of the troop.
Yeah.
It's supposed to represent America overall, yes. right? You got one of everybody. Tom Hanks's character, what does he do as a profession? He's a teacher. He's middle class.
Yeah, he's a
he's
English
white.
Teacher. Yeah.
He's everything you would want in a protagonist because he's an everyman.
If you're going to talk crap on Tom Hanks, I'm going to have to punch
you. I
love Tom Hanks.
As a human, I think he's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. As a human, I think he's okay.
He's okay. But I think I what I would disagree, though, with is that I don't see anything wrong with the realism of the scenes of violence in that movie. In that I think we've done unrealistic, glorious war films for too long. The Longest Day, for example. I mean, it's just so.
Well, and in that article, she positions Saving Private Ryan in the,
I'd imagine,
historiography
of film.
Quotes,
yeah.
Of film. Yeah.
And so I think it's good that she does that, and I'd be curious to read it. But I, you know, I'm hesitant to start tearing down a movie because it's too realistic, because that's a big reason why I appreciate, and I'm not trying to draw a comparison. I really am not. That's why I really appreciate 12 Years a Slave, because I know they're not the same thing. They're not, and I'm not saying they are, but I'm saying that's the first movie. And you could argue Roots is very also like very, was realistic, especially for like the time, but it's a realistic portrayal of war that veterans of that war have said is like, this is the most realistic thing. And I think that I'd rather have that than something that's unrealistic, I guess.
Well, here's my problem. 12 Years a Slave has an ideological message that we can agree with.
For sure.
I mean, very surface level that we can say, oh yeah, that was bad.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's problematic. Or, I'll take it back. It's not as problematic as the surface level message that is given by Saving Private Ryan.
Yeah.
Which is patriotic, nationalistic.
Definitely. Definitely patriotic. Definitely.
Right.
But also.
But.
Okay, keep going.
Just to cut you off, it's because I tried to problematize patriotism.
Yeah. And right? I'm not going to disagree with you.
So even
that.
If we say, like, it's a very accurate movie, it's an accurate portrayal, I think that's the problem, because it reinscribes these things that we take as assumptions, which are things like nationalism and patriotism. So.
But I don't see that. Well, I don't know. Hannah, do you have anything you want to jump in on real quick?
Well, I just like thinking of what you were saying after we talked about The Last of the Mohicans and how maybe it's the different media, like reading a book, you're able to kind of better like analyze something as being maybe not so straightforward. And then when you see it in film and you see these like actual people representing maybe more believable real human beings, it's harder to kind of be able to critique it and see it as fiction. So that's just what I've been thinking about.
And I think, yeah, and I think there's a reason. There's obviously a reason why he has the melting pot of characters. I mean,
right.
It's like, oh, I can identify with that guy. I can identify with that guy. I can, you know, there's someone always to identify with. But also,
except
African Americans, obviously, because.
But that's historically accurate.
Yeah, that's actually historically accurate. So
the military was not desegregated
at
this point. We
not
get
at all.
It.
They could work in factories producing arms, but they could not go fight. At least in combat positions. But the thing is that, like I said, I'm going to stand by my point and say that I would rather have a realistic portrayal of war than have, oh, this is, yeah, it just popped in my head again. Then I'd rather have that than Wind Talkers. Wind Talkers is a 2000, I think it's like 2002 or 4, I think it's 2002, movie by John Woo. And if anybody knows who John Woo is, let me tell you, he is Chinese director of action films. And if anybody has seen Face Off from the mid-90s with Nicolas Cage and, well, let me just give you this. The whole stereotype of doves flying through the air and people jumping through the air in slow motion firing guns, that's all John Woo. So thank you and you're welcome, John Woo, for giving us that. But the whole dove thing, like all that over-the-top stuff and like jumping through the air, guns, slow motion, that's all John Woo. He directed a World War II movie called Wind Talkers, which is about Navajo, I believe, code breakers during World War II in the Philippines, except of so many problems. But the issue, one of my main issues with that movie is that there are so many scenes in slow motion. There are so many scenes that are just like, look, he's diving through the air after an explosion of the bunker. Like, that is what I don't want out of my war films, because that doesn't do anything but say, look, it's like a Hollywood set. This is ridiculous. It's just like, it's over the top. Saving Private Ryan eschews all that and said, this is gross. This is gritty. This is like I said, visceral, like war. And I guess that's why I don't really have an issue with it as much in that respect, is because the other end of the spectrum is Dirty Dozen and, like, you know, Wind Talkers.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what? I think that's a good place to end. Because I don't think, first of all, I know I'm not going to convert you.
You're never going to convert me.
But I think, I just want to make the point that the grittiness of it makes it dangerous. Right. It makes it effective. That's the point, is that its accuracy makes it effective. And it could be effective in a good way. It could be effective in a bad way. It could be effective getting across the theme that the filmmaker is going for. I'm saying that that's the problem. You're saying that's one of its
Well, I guess what you're saying in a lot of ways could be that it depends on your audience and who's watching the film and who's interpreting the film. So for me, I don't know. Is that what you're saying? Because
it always comes back to we're historians and we're better at everything.
Well, yeah, we are. That's the truth. Speaking the truth, praise. But I think, you know, for me, like I said, that works for me as a film. Like, I'd rather see a realistic World War II film than see, and like you said, that's where realism stops. I mean, the characters are just like this kind of like you said, it's like this Dirty Dozen type thing of the trope of all these tropes and everything thrown around into this movie, but I don't know. I would rather see the realistic World War II film than see the Wind Talker slow motion explosions.
Well, I think for a large audience, I'm not sure if, because I see what you're saying, Lindsay, like that the grittiness, especially for maybe higher educated people watching it, it will be easier to fall into the way that the director wants you to see it. But I'm not really sure that having less violence would change anything. Because, I mean, like, in Last of the Mohicans, it is still kind of, like, there's some really, like, huge violent moments, yeah. But people are still going to, I think, believe that as much as they believe Saving Private Ryan.
Well, that's my thing. I don't have a solution. I don't pretend to have a solution. I would never tell Spielberg how to make a movie.
Yeah.
Because I think if you make it less realistic, then it falls in the same problems that we've talked about earlier.
Right.
What is it covering up? Who does it leave out? All these questions.
Yeah, exactly.
But I just would like to point out, like, what is a simulation? Why do we believe what we believe about the movie, given that we think it's realistic, right? That's my question. I'm going to cut us off there because
make a film again is what we're trying to say. Is that films should not be made anymore.
All of your movies are problematic.
Should all be David Lynch, postmodernist, crazy, you know, Inland Empire, Mulholland Drive. That's
Here's
what they
my
should
thing.
All be like.
I love superhero movies. Even if we admit that they are bad or they have bad morals or whatever, you take them as a cultural artifact, and you study them and break them down, and you enjoy it while you do it.
We can get into all the problems with superhero movies and what that says about it later.
We should just start watching supercuts of dash cam footage.
You know what?
Instead of movies.
That's the most realistic.
That's realistic there. That's real.
I want to push us ahead and take us to the lightning round.
There's a lightning round?
There's a lightning round.
It's awesome.
See, if you listen to the goddamn
podcast. Yeah, I was
going to
say, I was like, I expected
you
to win.
Know.
Something specific there. I was expecting
lightning
that.
Round.
Yeah, there's.
Oh, you gotta get it closer because it's not picking it up.
That is an awesome horn going off. If you can't hear it,
did it work?
Yeah, it worked.
Did everybody hear that?
Yeah, I think so.
Also, it's the app is called Mad Decent, and it's the best app that you can get for an
iPhone.
It's
not available on Android. I tried. Trust me.
Apple Master Race. Okay, so if you would do me the honor of giving me five numbers between 1 and 30.
3, 14, 28, 22, and 19.
Lightning round. Question number 3. your plane crashes and you get stranded.
I'm terrified of flying in planes. Why do you have to pick this one?
Because of a tornado.
God. Oh. God.
Your boat crashes on
better.
A deserted island.
Way better.
And you get stranded with only one movie on your iPad. What movie did you just download?
I would first ask, I have an iPad mini. Why would I put a movie on there that would use like all my gigs? So I would say, when did I get this larger iPad and where did this storage come from? I would say, okay, so one movie on a desert island that I have to watch. I would say Legally Blonde. And that's my reference to The Office for tonight. Okay, well, you know, if it was a movie on a desert island, I guess that's a different question than being asked, what is your favorite movie, right?
No, that's the point. I don't want to know.
I don't know, because I don't know my favorite movie necessarily. I don't necessarily want to watch it, but I'm going to go with, which is I've really been loving this movie, and I fell in love with it when I first watched it. I bought it on a whim because I saw it on a bunch of like top lists for like 2006, I believe. It's called Cache or Hidden, and it's by Michael Haneke, I think is how you say his last name. And he was the director, if you guys know, he's an Austrian director, of Funny Games, which got remade for the U.S., and The White Ribbon, which won Best Foreign Film in 2005, I believe, 2004 or 5. And it is a film about this French couple, this well-to-do French couple, middle-aged, receive like a videotape on their porch one day, and it is a videotape of their house being filmed for like 2 hours, and they don't know what it is or anything. And then he gets another videotape and has a picture attached, a very like childlike drawing on it, and they start getting all these videotapes, but it's of all of them, of their like their house being filmed. And then eventually it starts showing like the person driving to his childhood home. And it's a really unnerving movie.
Yeah.
And it's a really, really good movie. It really is. And it's in a lot of ways, it's an allegory for how the French treated the Algerians during their occupation and everything. And it's a really, really wonderful movie. And I think it was like $5 on Amazon when I bought it. And it was one of the best purchases I made film-wise. And it has Juliette Binoche in it. And I forget the male actor's name, but it's I would highly recommend it. And it is just wonderful. It will get inside your mind and it will stay there. And okay. Then you'll spend the next 3 days online reading reviews and like analyses of it. So yeah.
Lightning round.
Question number 14. What is your favorite kind of animal?
Favorite kind of animal. I didn't ever own one, but ferrets are pretty cool.
they smell
yeah,
so bad.
Do they smell? I don't know. Like I just, as an animal, like, in Ohio, they let you, like, you can keep them as pets. In California, you can't. I don't know what Nevada's. I should probably check on the Nevada law
Nevada's
soon.
Nevada's the fucking Wild West.
Yeah, it's the Wild West. We got ferrets everywhere. but no, I would say favorite type of animal. I've always grown up with cats and dogs. And I would say dogs. I would say dogs. I'm sorry. I love cats, though. Cats are, like, such a close second. But dogs, I mean, god darn it, man. They're just so cute. And especially my dog. Buddy, if you're listening, I'm thinking of you. You're beautiful. Yeah. Dogs. Sorry if that's a lame answer.
That's a good answer. Yeah. We had a debate over the nature of the question last time I asked.
What could possibly be the debate over the nature of the question?
The question is actually, what is your favorite kind of animal and why is it cats?
Oh, that's a good one. That's a good one. Yeah. Yeah.
Lightning round.
All right. Question 28. Would you rather own a video game studio, art gallery, record label, or publishing house?
Publishing house, and I'll give you the reasons why I wouldn't own the rest of them. Video game studio, no. I just know. I like video games are cool and everything, but unless I own the studio that makes Battlefield. No, I don't want to own Battlefield because they make some really awful games. They get a bunch of flack. So anyway, I would say not the record label because eventually I'll have to sell out and sign the terrible band that gets all the fans to buy their stuff, and that'll be how my record label stays afloat. So no, I'm not doing that. What was the other one? The art house? No, I'm not.
Yeah, art gallery.
No, I'm not owning the art gallery. That'll be
not
out of
into art.
That'll be out of. No, it'll just be out of business in like 2 days. And the publishing houses will probably be out of business in 3 days because of ebooks like the one Hannah owns. Yeah.
Okay. It's just,
but no, publishing house because, god darn it, yeah, publishing.
Well, you want to self-publish all your own research, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that also adds a layer of validity to your own work is when you publish your own stuff, you know, and it's not peer-edited, peer-reviewed.
Like, I thought this was so good. I thought I would publish it.
Yeah, I know. I thought I would, you know, really do myself the favor.
Lightning round.
Question 22, very appropriate for today. Sweet. Who is your favorite film director?
Favorite film director. You know, it used to be, I would say it was probably Paul Thomas Anderson, until I realized he directed like There Will Be Blood, Boogie Nights, Magnolia, more recently, Inherent Vice, Punch Drunk Love, The Master. And I just, oh my God. I watched The Master. I don't care who you are. That movie sucks. I'm saying it right. I'm going on record. It sucks. Like, it's just, it's so, if it was an hour and a half, it'd be great. But no, it's 2.5 hours. It's boring. It's dumb. There's some great acting in it, but I'm sorry. It's ponderous hipster nonsense. I would say my favorite, I'm just going on record.
Too much PBR.
Yeah, this is, I am the Andy Rooney of the show today. So I would say my favorite director, God darn it. I don't want to say Scorsese, but Scorsese makes some great films, but I just hated Wolf of Wall Street like with a fervent passion.
I also didn't like
it. It's the worst movie he's ever made.
I'm glad you didn't like it.
Awful. Nice. It's oh God darn it. On the spot, favorite director. That's so tough. I'm going to say it just because he made this movie, Nicholas Winding Refn. And you know what? Only God Forgives was terrible. It was an awful movie. I agree. But Drive is just so good. And I'm sure if you guys had some kind of... people are going to be like, oh, this movie sucks so bad. It was so boring. I didn't like it. There were no car chases that were... whatever. Drive, I love Drive. And I would say right now, he is my favorite director.
Okay.
Did you watch Valhalla Rising yet?
No, which means I'm basing all of this off two movies, and one of which I hated. So that tells you how much I like Drive.
I actually didn't hate Only God Forgives. It was hard watching Drive first and having such high expectations and then watching Only God Forgives, but yeah. I still enjoyed it.
No, I have a better answer, actually. Lars von Trier is my favorite director. He's made movies that I just love. I love Magnolia. I love Antichrist. I love Dogville. That is my answer. Lars von Trier. Nicholas Winning Refn, yes, you made
Drive. You
can't
go back on your word.
No, I went back on it. I'm reneging on my thing. Yes.
Okay.
Lars von Trier. Lightning
round. Last question. Paul McCartney walks into your house and asks you to... What?
I don't care. I don't care
that
you walk in my house.
That new artist?
No.
Yeah, the new guy. Yeah, Kanye West.
Yeah, he's new, right?
Yeah. It's Paul McCartney guy.
Paul McCartney walks into your house and asks to record an album with you. What instrument do you choose?
That's a stupid question. I want to choose a different one. I play drums. I play drums. Give me another question. That's stupid.
Okay. X-Men, Avengers, Justice League, or Suicide Squad...
I don't know who two of
those
are.
Suicide Squad.
Stupid one. I don't care.
There is a right answer.
I'm just going to start answering questions.
Yeah, start answering for me. All the stupid questions I'll give to Hannah.
Last one. Star Wars or Star Trek?
Oh, Star Wars in a second.
Okay.
Star Trek is literally the most boring thing ever until J.J. Abrams got a hold of it. And even then, I didn't care that much. But still, yeah.
But the lens flares just sucked you right in.
I grew up watching Star Wars. And I think the prequels were just like an abomination. And I'm hoping for The Force Awakens. I hope it's going to be great.
Yeah, I hope it's
good.
And
I know it will be because the trailer, the teaser that was 30 seconds was great. So I know the movie will be great.
Yeah.
Which is a great way to base your film opinions on.
Yeah. Well, of course.
30-second teasers.
Trailers, that's the way I evaluate all films.
Yes, yes.
I actually don't have the patience to sit through an entire film. So all I do is
watch teasers. I just watch like honest trailers of them when they make fun of them, when they make fun of the film. And that's how I watch the film. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Are we doing our recommendations?
Oh, shit!
Oh, my God, I remember something that Lindsay didn't remember.
To recommendations. All right, really fast.
Round it out. Supernatural, because I'm going to write a blog post about it.
Okay.
Get ready.
Watch. Yeah, she's recommending
Supernatural,
the show Supernatural.
Television.
Watch all 9 seasons on Netflix.
Yeah.
So you can prepare for Hannah's mega blog post.
Yep.
Steven.
No, Lindsay, you first so I can think.
Okay. My recommendation, I'm going to recommend The Perverted Dance by this Slovenian actor comic named Klemen Slakonja.
Oh, you took mine. Damn.
And it's the song we're going to go out on. I'll post the link in the show notes. Steven.
I'm going to say I recommend the album Tunnel Blanket from This Will Destroy You. It is incredible post-rock, drone-y, atmospheric, amazing. This Will Destroy You, Tunnel Blanket. Go listen to it.
I agree with that recommendation.
It's a great, great album. Yeah. I got it on vinyl too, bro.
Digital and vinyl.
Digital
modern
and
age
vinyl.
Old.
Yeah. Okay, now we're done. Thank you. All right, have a nice day. Thanks for listening to the Handsy Comprehensive Exam Podcast. Now let me warn you, this isn't Macarena, not to condense, not a serie, not Gundam style, and so on and so on. We stand no chance, there's no time for romance. It's time to dance, time for the dance. Catapult, we need to catapult.